Hello, and welcome back to another edition of JW Football Talk. I'm your host, Cody Johnson, along with my co-host, Cody Wolf. Let's cue the intro. You could tell them that I've been from hell and back. When the heat is on, I fire back. In this cold world, where your light is at, let's burn it down, fire back. You could tell them that I've been from hell and back. When the heat is on, all right, so we're back with y'all today. We're going to get to the Texans 7-round mock draft. Once again, the Draft Network is what we did this off of, and we're not just coming up with random scenarios. We did an actual simulator. So Draft Network, best simulator both of us have seen. If y'all want to try them out, go check them out on Twitter at the Draft Network. Let's get this started. But I actually want to get one thing off my chest is my philosophy for the Texans 7-round mock is there's a bunch of needs, mainly on the defense, you know, and I know we just traded Hopkins, but I do not think that is the biggest need on this team is wide receiver. So my philosophy is at 40, go best defensive player available, then grab your receiver at 57. There's no reason to get like the sixth or seventh best receiver in the class at 40 when you can get like the third best corner, the third best interior defensive lineman at 40. Let's start it off. At 40, I have Grant Delpit, safety out of LSU. I love this pick. If he falls, great pick if the Texans actually do it. Now, and I think it's actually realistic that he could fall. There's knocks on him for his tackling, of course. And I saw somewhere on Twitter, some guy that was in some front office for some team said guys like Ashton Davis and Jeremy Chinn could go before Grant Delpit. Great if that happens. That'd be great for us. If he falls at 40, I say you pull the trigger. He's going to be definitely the best player available, in my opinion, unless someone like, you know, Jerry Jeudy falls to 40, you know. So Grant Delpit, he's going to be your single high safety, your free safety. He's rangy. It makes plays on the balls. Again, like I said earlier, his one real knock is tackling. And I guess that's a big problem with a bunch of teams, but like we've said before, like we said in our first round mock draft, we had him going to the Jaguars, I believe. But your single high safety doesn't need to be laying the wood, like you said, like Mike Singletary.
Yeah.
So he's not – how often do you think he's actually going to get in on a tackle a game? Probably four times maybe. You know, he's there to play the deep routes, be the free safety, and that – getting him to pair along with Justin Reed allows Reed to play the box safety, which is what he's best at. He can do both, but if you can get a guy in there to play the free safety spot where Reed can focus on the box, I think it's a great fit. Plus, you still got Tayshawn Gibson who can come in and guard tight ends. Like we said in the last video, three safety sets, teams love them nowadays. So, Grant Delpit, that's my pick at 40. What's your thoughts?
Oh, if he is there at 40 and you guys don't take him, I mean, that's got how many hits could the Texans fan base take? That'd be too many. No, that's a guy. I love Delpit as well. Now, of course, the Cowboys, I may not necessarily love him at 17.
Right.
But everything you just said, I completely agree with. Yeah, I mean, he's got great ball skills. He has that deep center fielder, you know, production, mentality, skill set. It's kind of crazy that his stock hasn't really taken off like I thought it would. This last season may not have been as good as, you know, the year prior for him.
Or right.
But I just feel like that LSU secondary as a whole, because they were playing with so many leads every game, it seemed like, you know, there were some points thrown up and the defense kind of gets, you know, that secondary gets kind of disrespected a little bit.
Yeah.
But Delpit at 40, he fills a great need, and then man, you guys really have a phenomenal secondary going forward.
It definitely helps the whole secondary. You know, I know not the biggest need on the defense, but you got to pull the trigger on him if he's there at 40, definitely. So let's move on to 57. Brandon Ayuk out of Arizona State, wide receiver. I love Ayuk. He's 6 foot, doesn't have that elite speed, you know, like maybe like a Henry Ruggs or a KJ Hamler in this draft class. But, man, this dude is very good route running. Very good. I don't know if you watch a lot of film on him. His slant routes are deadly. He can take a 5-yard slant route to the house, you know, and that's not all he does. Stop and goes, out routes, posts. Yeah. So, Brandon Ayuk, you know, some Texans fans that are okay with the Hop trade are complaining, you know, Hop couldn't get separation. He was slow, blah, blah, blah. Yeah, whatever. If that's your problem with Hop, then you're going to love this guy. Brandon Ayuk was definitely able to get separation on a lot of his routes. He really came into his own this year. He was the number two behind last year's first round pick for the Patriots. N'Keal Harry, yes. Yeah. So really came into his own as a number one. I think he'd be a great fit for what I believe the Texans are trying to do at wide receiver. I don't think they go and get some big possession guy. That's just my thoughts on it. I don't think they trade Hop, you know, one of the best possession guys in the league, to just go get another possession guy to fill his spot that's going to be worse than him. I mean, he's going to be cheaper, of course, but to me it seems like they're going for this Kansas City Chiefs, New England Patriots kind of shiftier
offense.
Yeah, shiftier and fast, and let Watson get the ball and the receivers do the thing. So that's my thoughts on it. But what do you think?
No, I agree. And especially, you know, like you said, that Kansas City, New England thing where it's, you know, there's not just one, there's no Michael Thomas. You know, there's no one guy where you know where the ball's going and he's getting it. You know, spread them out with equally capable, adept, you know, players, regardless of how you and I feel about the Hop trade. You know, that in and of itself, if that is the intention there, is of course a viable way to, you know, conduct your offense.
Right.
And if this guy's route running is already as polished as you say it is, I haven't had a chance to really watch him that much. You know, I don't necessarily, because I think he's going to go higher than Dallas is going to go for wide receiver. So I haven't really looked at him.
Right.
But the quickest way for a rookie wide receiver to get on the field is to run good routes.
Right.
You know, that is the biggest thing. If you can be where you're supposed to be, then you're going to find the field. If everything else takes care of itself, you'll find the field.
Yep.
So, yeah, of course, obviously addresses a need for you guys. You know, I think that would be a good pick.
Pick number 90, I went Darrell Taylor, edge out of Tennessee. So, I didn't mention it before, but I definitely think, you know, my thoughts on the Texans regarding the edge need, I don't think they think it's that big of a need. So, don't be surprised if they don't address it as early in the draft as you may want. You know, they just re-signed Merciless. They got situational pass rushers and Duke Ejiofor and Jacob Martin. So I don't think they think it's that big of a need. So I don't be surprised if they don't go edge as early as most Texans fans, you know, think they will. So 90 Darrell Taylor out of Tennessee, Friggy good bend. The reason I think he's been going in the third or around this is he's kind of developmental. I wouldn't expect him to see the field immediately, which he would be situational pass rusher anyways. His main problems are play recognition and stopping the run. He needs to work on that a little bit. And then also when he's pass rushing, one thing he tends to do is he'll lean into the lineman on a pass rush set. And they get a hold of him, and he can't really get out of it. So work on that. I think it's a good pick. Again, developmental. Don't expect him to start right away. What's your thoughts on that?
Yeah, no, obviously, you know, Dallas with their needs. I've seen a lot of this guy as well, especially, like you said, where he's projected to go. That could be an area where Dallas, you know, strikes early.
Right.
You know, or at least earlier than I had predicted. But, you know, I really wish the Texans would address edge earlier than that. I know, obviously, you know, you guys have a lot of needs, but like you and I have discussed before, this isn't the greatest draft for edge rushers. You know, this guy from Tennessee, I mean, he's projected third. You know, teams may talk themselves into him in the low second, but I feel like any other year, this could also be a fourth or a fifth round guy.
Right.
Because like you said, he is very developmental, you know, and there are a lot of things that need to be coached up there. I agree. I feel like athletically and from a physical standpoint, you have what you need. It's just very raw.
Yeah.
And exactly. They always, and those guys put everything else together.
Yeah.
You know, in a timely manner.
Yeah, that's a good way to put it. But yeah, we'll move on to here to pick 111. Double dipped, kind of like you did in our Cowboys mock draft. Went KJ Hill, wide receiver out of Ohio State. KJ Hill, definitely going to be a slot guy. Don't have his size right here. I think he's about 6 foot as well. One thing about him that he's actually really good at from watching his tape is he knows how to get open. Let's say his football IQ is really good. The physicals aren't there. He didn't run a great 40. I think it was like a 4.6. But, again, slot guy who can bail the quarterback out, say when maybe he has to roll out of the pocket and then he needs a wide receiver to get open. KJ Hill, really good at that. He has great hands as well. Needs to work on his route running. The reason he won't play the outside is because he off press man, he's not very good getting off the corner. So KJ Hill, that's the reason he's really going in the fourth is because he's mainly a slot receiver. You know, teams prioritize the outside receiver over the slot most times. So that's my pick there. What do you think?
No, I agree, and I feel like it's honestly a situation that's similar to, you know, I double dipped, and I think, you know, Will Fuller, he's going to be a free agent after this year, right? You know, now, of course, those are not the same type of players.
Right.
But we're still talking about a deficiency in the wide receiver group, you know, so you lost Hop, you had Ayuk, you know, you had Hop, don't get me wrong, but I agree that there probably needs to be a little more depth there. You know, and as deep as this class is, why not? This is a great wide receiver class, so take advantage of it. You know,
right. Plus definitely warranted. The receivers we do have all have injury histories. You know, Will Fuller, Randall Cobb,
injuries, age considerations, contract considerations. So double dipping there. I agree. Good reason.
Yep. So let's move on to pick. We don't have. Oh, I'm sorry. That was our fourth round pick. We're moving to our fifth round pick, 171. I went James Lynch, interior defensive line, Baylor. So, again, like I said before, I'm a Baylor fan. I've been able to watch this guy. If he goes at 171, it's an absolute steal. This is a guy who, if he stays in school for another year, second-round talent next year. Does that make sense? So, James Lynch was in a 3-3-5 system at Baylor last year in the Phil Snow defense. He played actually edge in that 3-3-5 system. So for everyone who might not know the technical terms, I talked about it in a mock draft I did with Ruben at 713 Houston Sportscast. But 3-3-5, you have essentially you're running a 4-3, four defensive linemen, three off-ball linebackers who are playing in coverage. You pluck one of those defensive tackles out, and you put a third safety in the back, right? You're preventing the big play. So you're essentially letting those three guys up front just try to go and get to the quarterback the best they can against five offensive linemen. You know, he had 14 sacks last year, almost 20 tackles for loss, and was dominating the Big 12. He would actually be better, and he came out and said this, as a three tech, which is what he would be in our system, a three tech and a 3-4. I think it's a great pick. Steal at 171. Could definitely see him going before this. Carolina's the biggest threat because his old coaching staff, Coach Bull, is up there in Carolina, right? So, James Lynch, what do you think?
Oh, man. Obviously, you know, I was able to watch most, if not every single Baylor game this season as well. And I agree, total steal. In my mock draft, I he was there in the fifth for me as well, and I would have taken him. Every time. I agree that this guy is going to be one of those individuals that is selected far earlier than any of these draft experts projected. This dude explodes off the tape. This guy is a monster. when you use the word dominate, you're not using it lightly, because that's exactly what he did last season through double teams. Like you said, 3-3-5. You know, you shouldn't expect that sort of production, you know, from a guy who plays with only two other down linemen the mm-hmm. majority of the time, and yet it was there for him. I agree completely. If he would have stayed, you know, probably would have went higher next year, and I am stunned that he isn't projected, you know, higher than what he is.
The testing numbers aren't going to be – he's not going to pop off the chart in the testing numbers. I need to look more at his combine numbers. I don't think it was that great, but I also don't – the combine's overrated to me as well as you. So, James Lynch, that's the pick. Now, we don't have a sixth-round pick, but we have 3 7th-round picks. And just to start this off, I don't expect much from these guys. At best, they make the roster in special teams. You know, at worst, they're off the team maybe somewhere else, you know. But the first one, I went A.J. Green – cornerback out of Oklahoma State. He's about 6'1", definitely developmental, like every seventh-round pick is going to be. I don't have much to say on him. I've only watched a little bit. He's lengthy, which is good. You know, we love that, you know, kind of Lonnie Johnson type. Can play press man. It's just when he gets up against stronger receivers, he has a problem. It's hard for me to explain it because I'm not a corner guy. I really am not good at projecting corners. But it's just he has trouble. He gets bodied by them, I guess you could say. So A.J. Green, again, 7th-round pick. Just expect a special teamer at best, probably a practice squad spot. Pick 248, Alex Taylor, offensive tackle. Again, just a depth guy, can maybe at best be a swing tackle for you. Again, haven't watched much. 7th-rounder, I just went best available off of this simulator. There we go. God. But yeah, it's just he was the best available not wide receiver or corner. And I already got 2 wide receivers earlier. I don't really want to take another one, and I go corner at the 250th pick. So Alex Taylor, at best, swing tackle. At worst, he's not on the team to start the season. So we'll go 250. Levert Hill, cornerback. I've actually watched a little bit of him. He played at Michigan last year and was actually first team all Big Ten, but he's 5'10 as a press man corner. So the problem there is the Julio Jones of the world, the A.J. Greens of the world are going to get the best of this guy every time, you know. So he's definitely going to have to move in the slot, but he's got to get a little bit quicker with his hips in the slot, getting out of breaks. You're not going to be able to press a whole lot in man. I mean, sorry, press a whole lot in the slot. You know, you get the little shiftier guys that get around you quick. But and another knock against him is when he does get beat deep, he likes to grab to save the big play. That's going to call for a lot of penalties. But he does have potential. Like I said, first team all Big Ten. This is a guy, again, I would only expect special teams, but maybe can develop into something better. What are your thoughts on those 7th-round picks?
Yeah. I mean, you're throwing darts at the wall. And you're hoping something sticks. I mean, every team, I feel, you know, probably feels the same way about that to one degree or another. As far as your corner, Hill from Michigan, that's tough. A 5'10 outside guy, like you said, may not have the best hips for an obvious transition into the slot. So, yeah, the Julios and the Mike Evans of the world, are, you know, could probably make that guy's life miserable. But once again, maybe I've seen Rudy too many times. But I don't care really how big a guy, you know, how tall a guy is, you know, or things like that. If you can ball, you can ball for the most part. Of course, there are instances where physics and the laws of physics come into play and you can't defeat Julio. But
we're not also talking about a 7th-round pick, not a second.
Exactly. That's what I'm saying. Yeah. So that's just my personal philosophy. You know, height, not as big a deal, I feel.
Right. But as a press man, you know, it's a little bit deeper. So, but yeah, that's our my 7th-round mock draft for the Houston Texans. I posted the Dallas Cowboys one. If y'all want to watch that, I'll put a link to the description below. But that's gonna be all for today. Y'all have a good one.